Welcome to the Cisco Netacad Introduction to Network video series by Jason Johnson. This video is Module 2, Part 2 of 2. Basic device configuration. So device names, you're going to give your device names. You don't want to do things like Goofy and Minnie Mouse and things like that. What you are going to want to do is give those unique names that you know the location of. So the configuration command on any device should be, to give it a unique host name. And you'll, if you remember in Module 1, we talked about a logical layout. We talked about our laying out the network. That's when you do all your naming. When you do your layouts, when you're planning phase. And in this phase, you're just going to use the, you don't just make these up on the fly. You plan these out for your network. So by default, all devices are assigned a factory default name. It's either Cisco IO switch is switch or router. Woo, real unique, right? Router or switch. So guidelines, it needs to start with the letter. And these do need to be adhered to, by the way. You need to start with a letter, contain no spaces, end with a letter or digit, and use only letters, digits, or dashes, and be less than 64 characters in length. So that is the rules for rules of the road for host names. Start with a letter, can't start with a number, contains no spaces, ends with the letter or digit, uses only letters, digits, or dashes, and be less than 64 characters in length. And then to return to the switch to the default prompt, use the no host name global config, but to put your host name in, you would go configure terminal. So we get to our privileged exec mode, go to configure terminal. We're in our config, so we'd set a host name space sw-floor-1. And so now, if you notice when I input that, so instead of switch, it's now saying sw-floor-1. So when we go to log into that, that gives us a quick indication of which switch we're on. That's why we want to set a host name. Let's talk about password guidelines and security. We could spend entire classes, and you might check out the Introduction to Security course through the Netacad Academy. It's a really great course, and they have some good cybersecurity courses in there. Password guidelines, the use of a weak or easily guessed password, they are a security concern. You don't want to use easy passwords. 12345 is the password you put on your luggage. It's not a password you use for a router or a switch. So all networking devices should limit administrative access by securing privileged exec or user exec and remote telnet access with passwords. You should have passwords on everything. If you don't, you're going to have a bad time because somebody's going to break in at some point. So in addition to all passwords, they should be encrypted and legal notifications be provided by the message of the day. So here's some password guidelines. Use passwords that are more than 8 characters or in length. I usually try to go 12 or more. 12 is probably better, but at least 8. Use a combination of upper and lowercase letters, numbers, special characters, and or numeric sequences. And there's all kinds of debate back and forth on what's better passwords. Let's say you use 5 words of a password, you know, all dogs must be good today. And use that as a password, and then maybe put a letter in between or a number in between each one of those. Or do you put a big, long, complicated password? There's all kinds of debate on that. That's not what we're going to do here. We're just saying that it needs to have at least 8. It needs to have a combination. Avoid using the same password for all your devices. That's pretty self-explanatory. But if you use the same password for all your devices, and somebody gets one password for one router, all of your routers and switches are compromised at that point. Your entire network's compromised. But if you have different passwords for your privileged exec mode versus console versus all your different lines and all your different devices all have different passwords, then it's going to be a lot harder. So don't use the same password across all your routers and switches. And don't use common words because they're easily guessed. Don't use words that are common to your business or your workplace. So most of the labs in the course, though, are going to use Cisco or class. Just so you know, that's not best practice, but for our lab setting, it's okay for what we're doing here. Those passwords are considered weak, and they should never be used in what we call a production environment, but for our labs and our classrooms, it's perfect for them to be able to use. Configuring passwords. Securing user exec mode access on your switches or routers is important. You first want to enter line console configuration mode, and you can do that by typing configure terminal or config TERM. Using the line console 0 command in the global configuration mode. Next, you want to specify the user exec mode password using the password and then whatever your password is command. So you'd put a password in and then you'd put in your actual password. In this case, it's Cisco, which we've already discussed in a previous video, how Cisco is not something to be used in a production environment, but in our labs that we're learning here in the Cisco Academy, that's fine to use. Then you want to type in login. That enables user exec access using the login command. And then you want to secure privilege exec mode by going into configure terminal, typing in enable secret, putting in your password, typing exit, and then you've configured both your user exec mode and your privileged exec mode. Next, you want to secure your VTY lines. You want to enter line VTY configuration mode using line VTY 0 to 15. Put that command in, line VTY 0 space 15. Put in password and then your actual password. Type in login, press enter. Type login, press enter, then type your end, and then it'll move you back out. And you have put your password on the VTY line access. There's a note there that VTY lines enable remote access using Telnet or SSH to the device. Many Cisco switches support up to 16 VTY lines that are numbered 0 to 15. Next, you want to encrypt your passwords. The startup config and running config files display most passwords in plain text unless we encrypt them. To secure or encrypt the plain text passwords, you want to use the service password encryption command in the global configuration command. So you go into configure terminal, type in service space password dash encryption, and remember you can use your tab key to, you don't have to type that whole command out. You can type serv tab space pass, start typing that out, and then press your tab key. And then you want to type exit, and then you want to use the show run config command to verify that the passwords on the device are now encrypted. You want to double check that on your show running config file. And you can tell that because if you do before, you can check this by before you go into service password encryption, you can do your show run config and it will show your passwords in plain text. Then you run your service password encryption and then you will go in and it'll show you the encrypted information. So you'll know that your passwords are encrypted. The banner messages are what's going to show up when you first get into that router or switch. A banner message is important. It's going to warn unauthorized personnel from attempting to access the device. Is it going to keep the bad people out? No. But it's going to put a warning there so that you've covered yourself to say you're not authorized to get into this system. You want to create a banner message of the day on a network device using banner MOTD, message of the day, pound sign. The message of the day is in between that pound and the global config command. So here's what we would put in here. We'd do configure terminal, banner space, message of the day, or MOTD, space, pound sign, hashtag, authorized access only. You may check with your legal department or with your higher-ups in networking. For the labs here in Cisco, it's fine just to say authorized access only. But when you get into a production environment, you want to find out what legal terms or legal information or what authorized access only message you want put there on that. And you don't want to use the pound sign inside the pound sign, because if I did hashtag, I'm gonna call them hashtags, hashtag authorized, hashtag access only, hashtag, it's only going to take the first two hashtags. So the hashtag in the command syntax is called the delimiting character. It's entered before and after the message. Save configurations. Your configuration files, we have different configuration files. You have your startup, your run config files. Your startup config files are what's going to run when your device first starts up. That's saved in the config file there is saved in the NVRAM. It contains all the commands that will be used by the device upon startup or reboot. It's got all your encrypted passwords. It's got everything on there that's going to boot up. Flash does not lose its contents when the device is turned off. Running config, that is stored in the random access memory, or RAM. It reflects the current configuration that you've been working on. So if you've made changes, but you've not saved your run config over to your startup config, it's not going to save if you restart your device. So modifying a running config affects the operation of the Cisco device immediately. RAM is what we call volatile memory. So if you reboot the device or lose power, it loses all of the content when the device is powered off or restarted. So to save your startup, or to save your run config over to your startup config so that it, when you boot, you have that information, you want to use the copy run config space startup config, privileged exec mode command. So you want to be in privileged exec mode to show startup config. You can see your startup config, but then you can run the copy running config space startup config, and it will copy that over there. So the next time you boot up, it'll have it in there. So if changes were made to the running config, they don't have to if they don't have the desired effect or the running config has not been saved, you can restore the device to its previous configuration. If you just are working on the startup config, or excuse me, you're working on your running config and you've made changes and you just like, I just totally lost where I am on this, just don't save it. Don't copy. Don't run this copy running config to the startup config. Just restart it and you'll go back to your starting place before you started working on that. So you can remove the change commands individually. You can go back through and remove each one of them, or you can just reboot without saving it. If the undesired changes were saved to the startup config, it may be necessary to clear all the configurations. You can use the erase startup config, and that will erase all your startup configurations, and the next time you boot, it'll be a clean router or switch. This is what you're going to be using in the labs. If you're using, if you're not using Packet Tracer and you're using actual routers and switches in your labs, you're going to be erasing startup config files off your routers and switches after you're done with your labs, because you want to leave that for the next student that comes in on those routers and switches to have a clean device. You can capture your configuration to a text file. Your configuration files can be saved and archived to a text document. You want to open terminal emulation software such as PuTTY or TerraTerm. You want to enable logging into the terminal software and assign a name and a file location, and you can save that down. You can then execute show running config or show startup config at command at the privileged exec prompt. And disable logging in the terminal software. The figure shows how to disable logging by choosing none on session logging. And then you can create a text file with all of your configuration information. So then if you totally lost your device and you wanted to pull it back from a text file, you could do that. Ports and addresses. Ports and addresses, we're going to talk about IP addresses or internet protocol addresses here. The use of an IP address is the primary means of enabling devices to locate one another and establish connections or communication on the internet. The structure of an IPv4 address, and you're going to hear me call it V4 and V6. The structure of an IPv4 address is called a dotted decimal notation. It's represented by four decimal numbers between 0 and 255. An IPv4 subnet mask is a 32-bit value that differentiates the network portion of the address from the host portion. And it's coupled with the IPv4 address. The subnet mask determines which subnet the device is a member. And the gate, you'll hear gateway address. That's the IP address of the router that the host will use to access remote networks, including the internet. And this is on a Windows machine here, the V4 properties. V6 addresses are 128 bits in length, and they're written as a string of hexadecimal values. Every four bits is represented by a single hexadecimal digit for a total of up to 32 hexadecimal values. Groups of four hexadecimal digits are separated by a colon. And IPv6 addresses are not case sensitive, and they can be written in either lowercase or uppercase. And in this course, it refers to both the V4 and V6 protocols. V6 is the most recent version. It was first adopted in 1995, and it's now on most devices. It's the most recent, and V4 has been more common in the past, but it's will slowly, it'll be absorbed into V6, but we'll be using V6 going forward. Interfaces and ports. Network communications depend on end-user device interfaces, networking device interfaces, and the cables that connect them. So the types of network media included twisted pair copper cables, fiber optic cables, coax cables, and wireless. So the different types of network media have different features and benefits. Some will allow you to go longer distances. Fiber optics can go a longer distance than Ethernet copper, but it's also more expensive. So distance the media can successfully carry a signal, environment in which the media is installed. So it's if it's outdoors, it's got to have different shielding. It's got to be in pipes. It's got to be put in differently versus indoors versus if you have cabling that needs to be fire resistant or not put off the same amount of chemicals if it's burned. So there's different considerations on those and also the cost of the media and the installation of that. So fiber optics is going to be more expensive to put in than Ethernet because it takes special tools and special training. Configuring IP addressing. Manual IP address configuration for end devices. You're not going to do this very often in a production environment, but here in the lab, you're going to do this because you're going to set your end devices up with IP addressing. So your end devices on the network need an IP address in order to communicate. They can either get that from a manual or by a DHCP or dynamic host configuration protocol. So to manually configure that in a Windows machine, you would go into your control panel, go into network sharing, change adapter settings, and you can see the window over here, and you'd use the following IP address. If you use obtain IP address automatically, it will look for a DHCP service. If you use the manual here, it will use this IP address. Now, automatic IP address configuration, DHCP enables automatic V4 addressing configuration for every end device that's DHCP enabled. So end devices are typically by default using DHCP for automatic V4 address configurations. So that's what I just showed you on the previous screen. You'll automatically pick up that IP address. Switch virtual interface configuration. To access the switch remotely, an IP address and a subnet mask must be configured on the SVI, or the switch virtual interface. You would go in and put an interface VLAN1 command, and it would look like this, IP address, and you put your address in. We'll look at the example down here. So you'd go in interface space VLAN1, IP space address space, and then your IP address space with the subnet mask, and then no space shutdown. The no shutdown tells that line to be in an up state, so that will actually be on. Okay, so what did we learn in Module 2, Parts 1 and 2? We learned that all end devices and network devices require an operating system. We learned that Cisco IOS software separates management access into the following two commands, user exec mode and privilege exec mode. Those are important to learn. Global config mode is accessed before other specific configuration modes. From global config, the user can enter different subconfiguration modes. Each IOS command has a specific format or syntax and can only be executed in the appropriate mode. Basic device configurations, host name, password, encrypt passwords, and banner. We learned how to do that. And then that there's two file systems, or two system files, that store startup config and running config. And then IP addresses enable devices to locate one another and establish end-to-end communication on the internet. Each end device on a network must be configured with an IP address. And I'm going to make a note here about IP addressing IPv4. I do have a series of videos on YouTube. I'll put the links in the description below on IPv4 addressing and subnetting, and you can check those out. I hope this material was helpful, and I hope you have a great day.